When I came to, I was being bounced around, and I ached and smarted and wondered dimly where I was. I tried to think, but there was too high-pitched screaming going on. I couldn't tell whether it was inside my head or out. Then I realized it was a siren, the fuzz, I thought dully. The cops have come for us. I tried to swallow and groan and wished wildly for soda. Someone with a wet, cold rag was gently sponging off my face, and a voice said, "I think he's coming around." I opened my eyes. It was dark. "I'm moving," I thought. "Are they taking me to jail?" "Where?" I said hoarsely, not able to get anything out of my breath. My throat was sore. I blinked at the stranger sitting beside me. He wasn't a stranger. I'd seen him before. "Take it easy, kid. You're in an ambulance." "Where's Johnny?" I cried, frightened at being in the car with strangers. "And Dallas." "They're in the other ambulance right behind us. Just calm down. You're going to be okay. You just passed out." I didn't either, I said in a bored, tough voice we reserve for strangers and cops. "Dallas hit me. How come?" "Because your back was in flames. That's why." I was surprised. "It was? Golly, I didn't feel it. It didn't hurt." "Well, we put it out before you got burned. The jacket saved you from being burned, maybe saved your life. You just kneeled over from smoke inhalation and a little shock, of course. That slap on your back didn't help much." I remembered who he was, Jerry somebody or other, too heavy to get through the window. "He must be a school teacher," I thought. "Are you taking us to police station?" I thought I was still a little mixed up at what was coming off. "Police station?" It was his turn to be surprised. "What are you talking about the police station for? We're taking you three to the hospital." I let the first remark slide by. "Are Johnny and Daly all right?" "Which one's which?" "Johnny has black hair. Daly, the mean-looking one." He studied his wedding ring. "Maybe he's thinking about his wife," I thought. "I wish he'd say something." "We think the toe-headed kid's going to be all right. He burned one arm pretty badly, though, trying to drag the other kid out through the window. Johnny, well, I don't know about him. Piece of timber caught him across the back, and he might have a broken back, and he's pretty burned severely. He passed out before he got to the window. They're giving him plasma now. But I have to see look on my face because he hurriedly changed the subject. "I swear, you three are the bravest kids I've seen in a long time. First, you and the black-haired kid climbed through the window, and that tough-looking kid going back to save him, Mrs. O'Brien, and I think you were sent from heaven, or you were just professional heroes or something." Sent from heaven? Had he gotten a good look at Dallas? We're greasers, he said. I was too worried and scared and apprehensive to appreciate the fact that he was trying to be funny. "You're what?" "Greasers, you know, like hoods. JDs, Johnny is wanted for murder, and Dallas has a record that falls a mile along." "Are you kidding me?" Jerry stared at me as if he thought I was still in shock or something. "I'm not. Take me to town, and you'll find out pretty quick. They're taking you to the hospital there anyway. The address card in your billfold said that that's where he lived. Your real name, Pony Boy?" "Yeah, even on my birth certificate. And don't bug me about it." I felt a little weak. "Are the kids okay? Are the little kids okay?" "They're fine, just a little frightened maybe. There are some short explosions right after all you got out. Sounded like gunfire." "Gunfire? There went our gun and gone with the wind. We were sent for him from heaven." I started to laugh weakly. I guess that guy knew how close to hysterics I was, for he talked to me in a low, soothing voice all the way to the hospital. I was sitting in the waiting room waiting to hear about Daly and Johnny were. I had been checked over, and except for a few burns and a big bruise across my back, I was all right. I had watched them bring Daly and Johnny in on stretchers. Daly's eyes were closed, but when I spoke, he tried to grin as if he ever told me even the stupidest thing like that again, he beat the tar out of me. He was still swearing at me when they took him on in. Johnny was unconscious. I had been afraid to look at him, but I was relieved to see his face was unburned. He looked very pale and stiff and sort of sick. I would have cried at the sight of him still, I couldn't in front of people. Jerry Wood had stayed with me the whole time. He kept thanking me for getting the kids out. He didn't seem to mind our being hoods. I told him the whole story, starting out when Dallas and Johnny and I had met the corner at Pickens Station and left the part out about the gun and hitching a ride in a freight car. He was real nice about it, and he said that being heroes would help us get out of trouble, especially since it was self-defense and all. I was sitting there smoking a cigarette when Jerry came back from making a phone call. He stared at me for a second. "You shouldn't be smoking." I startled. "How come?" I looked at the cigarette. It looked okay. I looked around for a no smoking sign. Couldn't find one. "How come?" "Well," Jerry stammered. "Well, you're too young." "I am? I never thought about it. Everyone in our neighborhood, even the girls, smoked, except for Derry, who was too proud of his athletic health to risk a cigarette. We had all started smoking at an early age. Johnny had been smoking since he was 9. Steve started at 11. So no one thought it was unusual when I started. I was the weed fiend in my family's. Soda smokes only to steady his nerves when he wants to look tough. Jerry simply sighed and grinned. "There are some people here to see you. Claim to be your brothers or something." I leapt up and ran to the door, but it was already open, and Soda had me in a bear hug and swinging me around. I was glad to see him. I could have bawled. Finally, he sat me down and looked at me. He pushed my hair back. "Oh, Pony Boy, your hair. Your tough, tough hair." When I saw Derry, he was leaning on the doorway wearing his olive jeans and black t-shirts. He was still tall, broad-shouldered Derry, but his fists were jammed in his pockets and his eyes were pleading. I simply looked at him. He swallowed and said in a husky voice, "Pony Boy?" I let go of Soda and Soda stood there for a minute. Derry didn't like me. He had driven me away that night. He had hit me. Derry hollered at me all the time. He didn't give a hang about me. Suddenly, I realized, horrified, that Derry was crying. He didn't make a sound, but tears were running down his cheeks, and I didn't see him cry in years, not even when Mom and Dad had been killed. I remember the funeral. I had sobbed in spite of myself. Soda had broken down and bawled like a baby, but Derry had only stood there, his fists in his pockets, and that look on his face, that same helpless pleading look that he was wearing now. It was a second when Soda and Derry and 2-Bit had been trying to tell me came through. Derry did care about me, maybe as much as he cared about Soda, but because he cared about me, it was too hard to make something of me. When he yelled, "Pony, where you been all this time?" he meant, "Pony, you scared me to death. Please be careful, because couldn't stand if anything happened to you." Derry looked down and turned away silently. Suddenly, I broke out my daze. "Derry," I screamed. Next thing I knew, I had him around the waist and we were squeezing the daylights out of him. "Derry," I said, "I'm sorry." He was stroking my hair and I could hear the sobs racking him, and he fought back the tears. "Oh, Pony, I thought we lost you, like we did Mom and Dad." That was his silent fear then, losing another person he loved. I remembered how close he and Dad had been and wondered how I could ever have thought him hard and unfeeling. I listened to his heart pounding through his t-shirt and knew everything was going to be okay now. I had taken the long way around, but I was finally home to stay.